Hey everyone, and welcome back to another video. My name is Tilly and I am a strength and conditioning coach and an exercise scientist. Before we get into it today, it would be amazing if you could like and subscribe to help the channel grow. It would be wonderful to have you be a part of this little community that we have going on. Now today we're going to talk about all things hypertrophy. So we're talking about getting bigger muscles today. We're going to talk about the science behind how many sets you should do, how many reps, time under tension, volume load, and more. This video should hopefully provide you with all of the information you need to make sure that you are programming your sessions effectively and getting the best workout in. I mean, I want you to make the most amount of gains. So we're gonna start off by talking about arguably the most important thing in hypertrophy training. We're gonna be talking about volume load. Now, volume load is just a method of calculating how much work you've done in a resistance training exercise or a session. There are lots of different ways you can calculate this, but the most popular and the easiest one is by simply multiplying the reps times the set times the weight lifted or the resistance. So if I did 4 sets of 10 squats at 65 kilos, my total volume load for this would be 4 times 10 times 65. So it would equal 2,600 kilos lifted. Bar anabolic steroids, which I absolutely will not condone or encourage, volume load is the most crucial thing if hypertrophy is your goal. We can increase it by increasing the number of sets, the number of repetitions, the number of exercises, and the amount of weight that we lift. Volume load is really the guiding light for hypertrophy training. And there's lots of research to back this up. So for example, we know that multiple sets creates greater hypertrophy than single sets. If we continue this further, we know that 4 to 6 sets per exercise leads to more hypertrophy and more gains than 2 to 3 sets. Obviously, we'd build up to this if we're just starting out, but this is a really useful thing to know for our programming. Now, you guys may have also heard of something called time under tension. This just means that the amount of time that your muscles are under tension or that they're actively working against the weight. I'm just gonna call it TUT for now. You may have heard from other fitfluencers that TUT is really important, but we can't actually say for sure. There's still a massive question as to whether or not it's volume load or TUT that is actually the contributing factor to hypertrophy. This is usually because both go up at the same time. Because if we do more sets or we do more reps, we have more time under tension. So it's hard to kind of find that direct cause of hypertrophy and attribute it to TUT because it can already kind of be explained by the volume load. People will argue that TUT is different to volume load because you can just really slow down your movements. So you do them very controlled. That would make the TUT go up, but the volume load would probably stay the same. This idea kind of falls apart though because it has been heavily challenged whether or not you actually need the muscle damage that would come from doing movements very slowly in order to get hypertrophy. The research tends to suggest that we don't need muscle damage, and that eccentric training where the muscles are lengthening very slowly can cause a lot of muscle damage. Also, just as a side note, most people do eccentric training wrong. It's not going to do much just by lifting a normal weight. You have to do super maximal weights for eccentric training. That's when you're really going to get the benefit. Super maximal means really fucking heavy. So because we don't really need that muscle damage in order to get increased hypertrophy, that idea of time under tension kind of falls apart, but volume load still stacks up. Now with the rest intervals, lots of papers and lots of textbooks, when they're doing hypertrophy training, will recommend 30 to 60 seconds of rest. And this is done usually because there is a theory that acute changes in our hormonal environment contributes to hypertrophy. So for example, the theory says that if we take less rest, we get a bigger hormonal response, and then we get more hypertrophy. But does this stack up? Not really, and for a couple of reasons. Number one, women have different hormonal responses to men, but they're often able to make gains at similar rates. So the acute hormonal changes or increases in testosterone aren't as important for them. So is that really the only reason people are making gains? Also, generally, we can lift more repetitions and lift heavier when we have a longer, more appropriate rest time. And what does that mean? It means we're able to get a higher volume load with a longer rest time. There has been some work to suggest that longer rest might be better, even if the volume load was equated. So for example, you can see here that there was more hypertrophy in the long rest interval group, and then the long rest interval group where the volume was matched. It wasn't really statistically significant, but it does suggest that the longer rest times might be more beneficial. And they volume matched it just to see if it was the rest times that were the contributing factor or if it was that volume load. Because the results weren't statistically significant, it means regardless of the rest interval, if volume load is still high, you're still gonna cash in on hypertrophy. So sometimes we just don't have time to take like an optimal rest of 2 minutes in between each set, and that's completely fine. You're more than welcome to take shorter rest times if you're in a hurry or you need to get your workout done really quickly for whatever reason. But if your rest times are significantly compromising your volume load or the amount of reps, sets, and weight that you're able to lift, then we might need to rethink some of the strategies that we're implementing here. Do you get what I'm saying? We might need to try and organize a different time to go to the gym, even though I know that's not an option for everybody. Now let's talk about what intensity or what weight you should use and why. And this is ultimately going to be dictated by your primary training goal. It's also going to be dictated by whether or not you're competing in another sport or if you're just going to the gym to go to the gym. So if we increase the volume load by using lower weights or lower intensities, then we see more of an increase in type 1 muscle fiber area. When we increase volume load by using heavier weights, we see more of an increase in type 2 muscle fiber area. And this matters because type 2 fibers are responsible for our explosive, fast, rapid, our powerful movements. They're responsible for speed and change of direction activities. So they're absolutely needed for team sports and most strength and power sports. So if you're a team sports athlete, you might want to try working at a higher intensity for hypertrophy training. Now, this is not to say that hypertrophy can't occur when you're using lighter weights, but it is worth mentioning that you will need to include higher weights if you're planning on doing other activities or competing in other sports outside of the gym. On a similar note, even if going to the gym or bodybuilding is your only sport, you will still need to vary it and pick up some heavier weights every now and then, because consistently using light weights is not going to help you. You can conceptualize this by thinking about marathon runners. You could argue that each time the foot hits the ground, that's one repetition. So think of how many reps they're getting in every time they run. But the only load that they have is how their body weight interacts with the ground. That's the only load for a really stupidly high amount of repetitions. If low loads and high reps were all we needed to make hypertrophy or to make gains, then marathon runners would be the biggest people out there. And I know we're talking about hypertrophy in this video, but this is also a reason why bodybuilders aren't the strongest people out there. Because they often work with lighter weights, they have a higher percentage of type 1 muscle fiber content than other athletes do. And all of this seems to indicate that while volume load is still the most important factor, we do need to find some sort of balance between challenging ourselves with higher weights and higher intensities and challenging ourselves with the amount of repetitions or the amount of sets that we're completing. So we want to go through phases of higher intensities, higher reps, and then lower intensities, lower reps. Not necessarily paired like that, but you get what I mean. In saying this, if you've been in the fitness space for a while or you've been around the gym, you will have figured out that gains are not going to perpetually happen like this. They're certainly not going to occur in that linear fashion. So when you are planning out your programming, one way to do this is step loading. I've mentioned this briefly in another video, but it's really simple to understand. You could take the overall volume load that you complete in a week, and then you could bring it up each week for 3 weeks, and then you would drop it on the last week just to give your body a bit of a deload and to make sure that you are recovering appropriately. If you think that this sounds like too much of a pain in the ass to do or to calculate the volume load is too much of a pain, you could just do your program on Google Sheets and then it'll calculate everything for you. Just remember to multiply sets times reps times weight lifted. Then just sum up all the values for your whole session and then you've got the volume load for the day. You can see that I do this for my programming for myself. So this is one that my partner wrote for me and you can see at the bottom of each day, I've got the little volume load and I've just times those different squares there. You can also vary the volume that you lift throughout each day of the week. And this way you're still getting some variation and the recovery that you need to continuously make gains. You need to plan variation and steps and things like that, variations in volume load, because you cannot keep going up, 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 up. Here's just some examples of how you could lay out the volume load in a microcycle. So over the course of a week, you can see you've got some variation, some higher volume load days, some lower volume load days. And then if you had a game on the weekend, you would probably plan your higher volume load days days for earlier on in the week. On that same note of variation in volume load, switching up your training goal every now and then can be a really good way to ensure that you are still progressing. It can also ensure that you don't have a high training monotony or strain, and you're not at risk of overtraining or overloading yourself. This is one example from a textbook of how you could structure about 16 weeks worth of programming, but the focus still remains on hypertrophy. This kind of idea would still allow you to remain functional. I hate that word, but it's just, I don't know, an idea. Now, in terms of how many reps you should do, as long as you're not training to failure and you're adding some variation in your programming every now and then, you probably can't go wrong. The general rule of thumb for hypertrophy is 8 to 12 reps, but I have seen it recorded as 6 to 12 reps as being the sweet spot. This is where some researchers estimated the sweet spot would be for lean body mass increases and hypertrophy. Any higher than 12 reps is probably focusing on muscular endurance, and any lower is kind of dipping into that realm for strength. It's really up to you which way you prefer to train, what you have the time for, and what your overall goal is. And like I said, there's just really no wrong way to approach this if that volume load is staying relatively high. There are so many different factors to consider. As always in strength and conditioning, it depends is the amazing, amazing saying that underpins absolutely everything we do as a coach. And it underpins every decision that we make for athletes and clients. Unfortunately, it depends does not sell as well as absolute statements of do this and do that. Ah, well. The last factor that I wanted to talk about in regards to hypertrophy is protein intake. Now, I have a whole video on this, so I'm not gonna repeat any of the stuff that I mentioned over there, but please go check it out if you're interested. But I wanted to mention something really cool. It's a bit sciencey, a bit nerdy, but you'll love it. And this is called the leucine trigger hypothesis. Leucine is a really important amino acid, and amino acids are the building blocks for proteins or our muscles. And there is a theory that there is a leucine trigger zone. When we consume protein and we enter this zone of elevated blood leucine concentration, that's when muscle protein synthesis increases, aka we make gains. And now I know a lot of people in the gym and a lot of athletes, myself included, love a good protein powder to help them achieve that goal of reaching their protein intake and to try and help them make more gains. But according to this hypothesis, there is an interesting distinction between the amount of time that we spend in that leucine trigger zone when we get our protein from whole food sources as opposed to when we get our protein from an isolated protein concentrate, so like a protein powder. You can see that we spend a longer amount of time in that leucine trigger zone when we get our foods from whole food sources. Now, isn't that really cool? Isn't that so interesting? So that could be pretty good evidence that we want the majority of our protein to come from our food, not from protein powders. I think that's really cool. And that is it for me today, everybody. I have referenced all of the amazing articles down below. I highly recommend that you check them out. I've tried to find the open source ones where I can. I know there's so many more things that we could talk about in terms of hypertrophy, but I just thought that those were the really important ones that I wanted to cover. Let me know if you think I missed anything or if there are other really crucial parts to hypertrophy that you would include. Are there any bits of information that you would add in this video as the most important parts or the most important factors to consider for making gains? So that's my question to you to end up this video. But anyways, that is it for me, guys. I hope you learned something cool, and I hope you have the most amazing week ahead. As always, if you could like and subscribe, that would really help the channel grow, and I would really appreciate it. I'll see you guys next time. Bye.